Ciao Raffa!
How are you guys? Ciao Fede!
I kicked the tripod here in my wannabe podcaster setup. Nothing, all good.
You are so professional in this moment because we are recording. I'm pretty sure that if we weren't recording, you would say the scream like in the other buildings or something.
Yes. Can I say that probably today is gonna be one of my favorite episodes of the podcast?
We can say that, and I'm looking forward to listening to you. We're talking about the Enterprise UX.
Oh yeah.
What is your definition of Enterprise UX right now?
Enterprise UX, some people call it employee experience, some other people call it enterprise collaboration, some other people, I believe they call it digital workplace. So there is a number of names. Another fancy one is probably workforce of the future, work of the future. So all these fancy names, I like to call it enterprise UX. I would like to start with what is not, because when you think about enterprise UX, you will think that is the design of software that helps people do their jobs. And I don't believe it's that. It's not that small. It's not just the discipline of design applied to internal tools. It's a part of that, but it's definitely not what the enterprise UX is. If I were given the freedom to define what enterprise UX is, and that's probably going to be the worst definition ever, but to me, enterprise UX is more the design of a set of holistic working experiences.
Holistic working experience, guys.
I will call them holistic working experiences. I will tell you why. That really focus on empowering the employees in being successful in their work. And they help developing a genuine sense of belonging towards the company they work for.
You used a very specific verb that I really like it, that is empowering. That is more than just give fuel to the car, you know? It's something more. It's just, okay, I'm fueling your car, but in the same way I'm taking care that you know your the road. That you know, I mean, that your car is everything fine with lights, with wheels, and I'm giving you all the best to succeed. And this is something as employee, as a future employee, this is something that, I mean, it's mind-blowing for me right now.
I believe that's the new paradigm, and that's how it should be. If you think about that, and working in Italy, yes, still today it feels like, oh, I have a job, I better to keep it. I better do everything I can to keep my job and do everything I can in order to make my company successful. I don't believe
I know this song.
Right? So in every successful experience or relationship, because eventually a working relationship, it's very similar to dating relationship or any sort of relationship that you have with an entity, with a person. It's important that you have an exchange of values, right? And that means that they should both benefit of being in that relationship. Otherwise, the relationship will never last longer. It will never be a strong relationship. And you will. That's why I say you will never develop a sense of belonging towards that relationship. Because only if you trust your company, only if you like the company you work for, only if you feel like the company is giving you back, then you're willing to put everything you can in that company. So I believe it's not even the new paradigm. This should be the paradigm. That's why I think it's so important that Enterprise UX designed for this.
I think that you touched a point that we discussed in the networking episode about the exchanging values. But in that stage was regarding the networking part. I can see that there's a huge similarity between the two paths. So I would point out how different the scope it is in Enterprise UX.
It totally makes sense, and there is no difference, would be my honest answer. Like, as I said, it doesn't really matter if you get the concept of being in a relationship, whether it's with your partner, whether it's with someone that you'll be working with or whether it's with your company, again, there should be that value exchange. If you can set up that value, mutual value exchange, then everything is going to work, right? If you keep fighting with your partner, you're probably going to split, right? There is no interest in people that keep on fighting or that cannot get along or are not aligned to the success of both of them. So that is the
and
key
since
part.
Our listeners are not masochists, but they want to succeed.
What I'd like to add is that this is something that you should own and be very confident about. Because I still feel like when you're going and when you're interviewing, of course it's tricky, of course it's hard, it's never gonna change because getting a job is hard. But everything comes from this sort of attitude where, oh, let's hope that I can get this job. They're actually almost like giving, doing me a favor. It's not like that. It's mutual interest. A company will hire you if they believe you are the best in the role. And you will should be interested and should really value and evaluate the company only if you think you can get something from them. If not, then you're probably not interviewing for the right company. So the thing I'm saying is, even when you're looking for a company that represents your ideas, your mission, your North Star, it's a mutual relationship. So it's not like they're doing you a favor. You're creating a relationship.
I would say, don't be a dreamer. Is that correct? Because you know that there's a personal experience recently. So you helped me a lot in this way. And to a bigger scope related to enterprise UX, I would just add that even hiring, it's part of the UX in a company, right? So the hiring culture. Enterprise UX is in hiring, is in IT, is in ops, it's in...
It's everywhere.
It's not just the value that the company itself ships.
No,
because at the end, it's the that now I'm feeling your definition of the holistic working experience. Yeah,
that's why I call it holistic. You said it right. I mean, I think enterprise UX the scope is huge. The enterprise UX, as you said, I think ideally is in the intersection of IT, HR, corporate strategy, and internal communication. If you want to focus on the probably the departments that enable enterprise UX. So if you want to get tactical or functional, these are the teams that need to work together to deliver the enterprise UX. But the scope of enterprise UX goes, they call it hire to retire. So from the moment people get considered to be hired to how they start in their job, what they do every day, how they work with their team, how do they work with their boss? How do they report to the people that are working for them? How do they network? It's everything. It's a combination of what I like to say are the micro moment and the micro moment that you have in your daily life, the daily grind. So if you think about it, you have some macro moments such as I'm getting married, I'm having a baby. And that's where companies have a lot of even important benefits, right? Paternity leave, maternity leave, and help you like, you know, restart your work when you get back. But then there are some micro moments that are as well as important as the macro, such as every day I open my intranet and it sucks. I cannot find the information I need. I need to call 3 different dial-in to get connected. I don't have one chat. I have 5 of them.
And think of this, I'm just having this idea in my mind right now. Now, compare this lack of services to the lack of humans interactions or, I don't know, human, I don't want to say confidence because it's still work, but something that can enable you to be yourself in a way that you should not feel like you are at work, but you are like at home.
It sounds awesome. I call it, I think I was trying to frame it like a fancy name and I was trying to call it something like fluid or liquid workplace, especially now that it's a remote. Because it's I like fluid because it's now with remote connection and everything because of COVID, it's really getting to another level. If I have to explain to someone, I mean, we discussed about the scope of the enterprise UX. Some people believe that might be just, you mentioned, it's not just service design though. Service design is a part of that. Software design is a part of that. But it's also all about the workplace design, so the literally the physical space that you interact with.
The workforce.
The workforce and the workplace, both of them. So where do you work when you get into the office, and how do you interact with the people that you work with? It's all about the culture. So who do we want to be as a company? What culture is a huge thing to solve for employees.
Wow.
It's also very grounded in what we call inclusive design. So the sense of belonging happens only when, you know, diversity, inclusion, and equality is granted for everyone. If you don't do that, so in, diversity and inclusion is another big theme. So you, can you see how big it is? It's ginormous.
It's huge. And I would like to leave our listeners with a question that I have direct for you. My question for you is, what are your biggest concerns right now as a strategist? So what should companies have to take care of the most for value their enterprise UX post-COVID for their employees?
I will probably answer your question by reframing it, because I do think that COVID allowed all the companies in the world to put back the focus on their employee and employee UX in general. Let me give you a little bit of context. Typically, enterprise UX is the next thing, because it's never priority one. If you work for customer services, customer always have the priorities. But now that all the world is on pause to some extent, we realize that the best, one of the most important, if not the most important asset that company has are their people. And all those leaders are putting even more focus and budget in developing a better enterprise UX. So I don't believe that there should be any concern by part of those company. I believe the company learned that lesson. And I believe that this pandemic accelerate the quality and the development of a better enterprise UX in the last 3 months. Just think about the remote working, the smart working. I'm not talking about Silicon Valley, but Italy. I've never been even trying with smart working. It was 9 to 5, clock in, clock out, bam, bam, always at the office. So just think about that. Then we can argue that working from home might not be called smart working, but dumb working if you don't do it right. That's another topic, but...
That's another episode.
Yeah, exactly. It might be another episode. But if you think about the change element, the disruption happened. If you think about the change of focus, it did happen. And I believe that overall, now that's why we want to call it the rise of enterprise UX. Because now people really perceived what the hell enterprise UX is and why it's so important.
This, I think that this is a topic that, for example, before knowing you, I wouldn't be able to make a definition.
There is one thing that I'd like to close with. We wanted to do this episode, as you said, because there is a little bit of confusion, and many new designers that are facing the professional life asking themselves, what should I do? I want to work with someone and create stuff for users. And I will encourage them to evaluate enterprise UX as a career. It's not an easy career and it's different, but it's definitely on the rise. There are a few things though that you want to keep in your mind when you're considering enterprise UX, because now that we have a definition, there are some differences with working on an app like a Spotify or anything that will be a TikTok. When you talk enterprise UX, we already mentioned that the scope is huge, but it's also much more complicated and sophisticated than probably a typical app. If you think selling a t-shirt might be complicated, right? Okay, now try thinking about creating a quote and then an invoice and configure an office setup for someone that is calling you on the phone. So the use cases that you will be facing will be incredibly more difficult. The number of data points that we'll need to get, the number of tools that you will need to get are way more complex. And are not so user friendly, because you, I don't want to mention any name of those company, but you are not creating an app from scratch. There are CRM, there are ERP, there are systems that pretty much provides data and function that are not, were not born user friendly. So it's super fascinating to me because you are changing the way people work and get their stuff done. But that's a huge difference. It's not like doing a Super Bowl commercial. Everyone wants to do the Super Bowl commercial.
Is that that fancier part? Is it a completely different challenge?
Enterprise UX is truly my passion. I call it my bread and butter, how they say here in the US. And if anyone has like question about it, wants to know more, or have more example, or if you have specific question, more than happy to do any spin-off episode. But I think that was a great start. So thank you for
you have
asking me all those questions.
Guys, go to the Medium of Federico because there's an article from 2 years ago that looks like he wrote that yesterday. And we will share the link. Oh, it's about the employee experience and it's amazing.
I love this episode. Hope you guys like it too. Rafa, I'll see you next
Thank
time.
Thank you so much. We even created a Twitter account, so please.
Oh.
So find us on Twitter. It's designers_audio.
designers_audio. Okay, I'll go and follow.
That's me.
Bye, guys.
Absolutely. See you then.
Ciao.
Ciao, ciao. Have an amazing one.